madness of the people.
And also the blood and the utmost parts of the earth shall be offered again to the righteousness. Thou makest thy rise in the morning and evening to praise thee.
Thou didst fill the earth and blessed it. Thou makest it very precious.
The river of God is full of water.
Thou preparest
their pool,
thou
sowest thy righteousness for the earth.
Thou waterest their furrows and sendest rain into the hidden valleys thereof. Thou makest it soft with drops of rain, and blessed be the increase of it.
Thou preparest the year of thy riches, and thy harvest of thy hands.
They shall drop upon the dwellings of the wilderness. Little hills shall rejoice on every side.
The cross shall be before sheep, and thou mayest also be the hands of the people, and they shall harvest it.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, now and shall be, world without end. Amen.
O be joyful in God, O ye lands. Sing praises unto the honour of his name. Make his praise to be glorious.
Say unto the Lord, O Lord, O Father, and O Jesus. Your grace is our power, and our ends are our lives.
For all the world shall worship you. Sing with me your praise, my Lord.
O God, and the Lord, and all the works of God. Our honor and it is to do it to all the children of man.
Eternal seed to dry land. So that they went through the water on the foot, and there they did rejoice thereof.
He ruled with his power forever, and his eyes for all the people. And such a one of you shall not be able to offer.
Praise our God, you mean. May the voice of his praise be heard.
Who calls on the soul of the night, and such a one of our hearts Jesus did.
Thou, O God, hast moved us. Thou hast tried us like silver strand.
Lessons taken from the 31st chapter of the book of Genesis, beginning with the 22nd verse. When it was told Laban on the third day that Jacob fled, he took his kinsman with him and pursued him for 7 days and followed close after him into the hill country of Gilead. But God came to Laban, that Aramean, in a dream by night, and said to him, "Take heed that you say not a word to Jacob, either good or bad." And Laban overtook Jacob. Now Jacob had pitched his tent in the hill country, and Laban and his kinsmen encamped in the country of Gilead. And Laban said to Jacob, "What have you done that you have cheated me, and carried away my daughters like captives of the sword? Why did you flee secretly and cheat me, and did not tell me, so that I might have sent you away with mirth and song, with tambourine and lyre? And why did you not permit me to kiss my sons and my daughters farewell? Now you have done foolishly. It is in my power to do you harm. But the God of your father spoke to me last night, saying, 'Take heed that you speak to Jacob neither good nor bad.' And now you have gone away because you longed greatly for your father's house. But why did you steal my gods?" Jacob answered Laban, "Because I was afraid, for I thought that you would take your daughters from me by force. Anyone with whom you find your gods shall not live. In the presence of our kinsmen, point out what I have that is yours, and take it." Now Jacob did not know that Rachel had stolen. So Laban went into Jacob's tent, and into Leah's tent, and into the tent of the two maidservants, but he did not find them. And he went out of Leah's tent, and entered Rachel's. Now Rachel had taken the household gods, and put them in the camel's saddle, and sat upon them. Laban felt all about the tent, but did not find them. And she said to her father, "Let not my lord be angry, that I cannot rise before you, for the way of the woman is upon me." So he searched, but did not find the household gods. Then Jacob became angry, and upbraided Laban. Jacob said to Laban, "What is my offense? What is my sin that you have not pursued me? Although you have felt through my goods, what have you found with all your household goods? Set it here before my kinsmen and your kinsmen, that they may decide between us two. These 20 years I have been with you, your ewes and your she-goats have not miscarried, and I have not eaten the rams of your flocks. That which was torn by wild beasts, I did not bring to you. I bore the loss of it myself. Of my hand you required it, whether stolen by day or stolen by night. Thus I was. By day the heat consumed me, and the cold by night, and my sleep fled from my eyes. These 20 years I have been in your house. I have served you 14 years for your two daughters, and 6 years for your flock, and you have changed my wages 10 times. If the God of my father, the God of Abraham, and the fear of Isaac had not been at my side, surely now you would have sent me away empty-handed. God saw my affliction and the labor of my hands, and rebuked you last night." Then Laban answered and said to Jacob, "My daughters are my daughters, the children are my children, the flocks are my flocks, and all that you see is mine. But what can I do this day to these my daughters, or to their children whom they have borne? Come now, let us make a covenant, you and I, and let it be a witness between you and me." So Jacob took a stone and set it up as a pillar. And Jacob said to his kinsmen, "Gather stones." And they took stones and made a heap, and they ate them by them there by that heap. Laban called it Yegas Hamutha, but Jacob called it Galeed. Laban said, "This heap is a witness between you and me today." Therefore he named it Galeed, and the pillar Mizpah, for he said, "The Lord watch between you and me, when we are absent one from the other. If you ill treat my daughters, or if you take wives beside my daughters, although no man is with us, remember, God is witness between you and me." golden horn. The God of their father judged between us. So Jacob swore by the fear of his father Isaac, and Jacob offered a sacrifice upon the mountain, and called his kinsmen to eat bread. And they ate bread and tarried all night on the mountain. Early in the morning, Laban arose and kissed his grandchildren and his daughters, and blessed them. Then he departed and returned home. Jacob went on his way, and the angels of God met him. And when Jacob saw them, he said, "This is God's army." So he called the name of that place Mahanaim.
Down the mighty from their seat, and hath exalted the humble and meek. Thank you. We who commemorate the Holy Mother of God may triumph over our iniquities with the help of her intercession through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Latest book, The Mission and Ministry
of the Church in England will be available after this lecture at the reception we're having in the Chalmers Hall, to which everybody is warmly invited. To get to the Chalmers Hall, you simply go through that door, and it's the third door on the right, down the stairs. Msgr Nazir-Ali is currently the director of the Oxford Centre for Training, Research, Advocacy and Dialogue. In 2021, he was received as the full communion of the Catholic Church and ordained to be a priest for the Ordinaries of Our Lady of Walsingham in October 2021. He was later appointed as a prelate of honour with the title Monsignor. Since his ordination as a Catholic priest, he has been invited to give lectures and seminars across the Catholic world, and last year was appointed a professor University of St. Thomas in Rome, known usually as the Anglican. Michael is married to Valerie, and they have two sons. His interests, other than theology, are cricket, hockey, table tennis, Scrabble, listening to music, watching television. He enjoys reading humour and detective fiction and poetry. He himself writes poetry in English and in Persian, and has his these have sometimes been published. So we welcome Msgr Nazir-Ali to deliver this first lecture in honour of the late Pope Benedict XVI, under whose pontificate the Apostolic Constitution Anglicorum Chaetatis was published, which allows for the preservation of some aspects of the Anglican tradition in the Universal Church. Who better then to deliver a lecture entitled What is Anglican Patrimony, and is it worth preserving? Msgr Nazir-Ali, we welcome you.
Thank you very much, Msgr Keith, for that generous introduction. I see that the clock in this church is on your side, so you can see how long I've been going on, but I can't. That is my excuse anyway. Well, it is a great honor to be asked to do this inaugural lecture. I'm very conscious of that. And I want to begin, as you might expect, with what Pope Paul VI, another pope, had said about Anglican patrimony and the canonization of the English martyrs, when he said that when the Roman Catholic Church is able to embrace her ever-beloved sister, the Anglican Communion, nothing of legitimate Anglican prestige and patrimony would be lost. So it is quite appropriate for us to ask, what then is this patrimony that we keep talking about and for which a provision was made by Pope Benedict himself? I want to begin really with a question that is more radical perhaps than just the question about patrimony. And the question is, what has Ecclesia Anglicana to do with the Catholic Church? What is its relevance? By Ecclesia Anglicana, I mean, first of all, of course, that English church that existed, well, let us say, from the 6th century, I mean, these things can be debated, up to the Act of Supremacy in 1534. So, in a number of ways, in the correspondence with Rome, and of course, famously in Magna Carta, this church has been referred to as Anglicana Ecclesia, or Ecclesia Anglicana, depends on your preference. And before we get into matters that have arisen since the separation, and they have arisen since then, and also about the present and the future, let us first look at this patrimony, what this patrimony appears as from that time onwards. So when we think of the mission of St. Augustine beginning, of course, from the south, began in Canterbury, but very soon his missionaries reached Rochester, and St. Justice, the first Bishop of Rochester, baptized the Anglo-Saxons in the Medway, which I thought was very brave of him and very brave of them. if you know what the temperature in the Medway is like. I'm not sure what month it was, but whatever month, the temperature would have been challenging. That mission, of course, worked its way up the country. But there was, and I think we must acknowledge this, there was another mission that was working its way down towards the south, beginning with the inheritance of the Irish monks who come to Iona, St. Columba, but then who were sent across to Lindisfarne to support the Christian king there. And that mission also was engaged in the Christianization of these islands at the same time. So we have figures like St. Aidan, St. Chad and his brother Sed, and many others who were engaged in that mission. The resolution of the various tensions that there were, it's not my place to discuss them tonight, and the Synod of Whitby, for the sake of unity and of peace, is something that was significant for the church here. But both movements need to be recognized, and I will tell you why in a moment. But the organization of the English Church was carried out later on by Archbishop Theodore of Tarsus, who arrived in this country at a ripe old age. He wasn't a young man. Along with his companion Hadrian the African, who was, of course, first asked to be the Archbishop, but he refused, and he said, "No, I don't want to be Archbishop, but I'll go with whoever you choose to the vote and help you." And he did, so he came with Theodore. Now, Theodore of Tarsus is known for having established the parochial system in this country, and thereby having a very long tail, of course, because the parochial system was a sign of Roman organization, if you like, as against the Celtic model. But it also had to rely on the feudal landlords for the land, for the church, and also for the priest, and the arrangements of the priest being a freeholder. That is from where this term comes. So he was not a serf of the Lord, although he had derived his lands from him, but he was a freeholder. While the parochial system was being organized, not just for the church, but also it became an important unit of administration in the land as such, Hadrian the African was putting in place the church's engagement with education. Schools, not just attached to monasteries and cathedrals, but also to parish churches. So the engagement of the church with education goes back a very long way. And when people ask today, why should the Catholic Church or the Church of England be engaged in education? Well, the answer to that is the state is very much a Johnny-come-lately to this matter. A very welcome Johnny-come-lately. But nevertheless, the church has been the pioneer in this area. When we think of the mission from Canterbury and the Celtic mission from the north, the mission from Canterbury is characterized by its emphasis on presence, on creating an ecclesial presence in every local community. This remains important in history, it remains important for today, and I believe it remains important for the future. Christian presence, a church presence, a priestly presence in every local community. This attachment to an incarnational view of thinking about the church has been characteristic of Ecclesia Anglicana. The Celts, of course, were different. They liked roaming about. peregrination I've called it in this book. That's a long word, of course. But that alerts us to another facet of the story of the English Church, which is, of course, mission, with missionary. And I could mention several features of it, but I just want you to note the work of the three W's. Winfrid came to be known as Boniface, the apostle to Germany, who was schooled by both sides, the Benedictines on the one hand and the Celts on the other. And so when he went to Germany, of course he roamed about. He went around cutting the sacred oaks of the pagan Germans, and when nothing happened to him, they decided that his God must be better than theirs. That goes back to the Christianization of Germany. But he also set in place an organization for the church in Germany, which has endured over the centuries. And then there's Willibrord, the evangelist of the Netherlands. Again, a school by both sides. His formation was something that he owed to both the Latin mission and the Celts. And he reached as far as Denmark. But even Wilfrid, who was a Latin by temperament, well, temperament is quite a good word for Wilfrid, because he had one, as Theodore found out. And in his several appeals to the Pope against Theodore's enormity, as he saw, well, yes, I mean, this was a legal matter, quasi-legal matter, but on his way to Rome, he engaged in mission. See, so he became a Celtic, certainly. He assisted many of the missionaries there. So the English Church was very active on the continent in those early centuries, in mission, in bringing about a church in many of those countries, including later on Scandinavia. What I'm saying is that part of the patrimony is, on the one hand, presence in every local community, and secondly, on the other hand, it is mission. It is going about, it is going out in mission. And this is something that we need to continue to remember. But then there is also what you might call the contribution to the emergence of organized public life after the collapse of the Western Empire, of the development of law, and of humanitarian concern, in which the English Church played a very major part. So I have in mind Alcuin, again schooled in York, that meeting place of the two traditions. But then, when he arrives at the court of Charlemagne, it is he who is responsible for the emerging idea in Europe that all human beings are equal. Every ancient civilization has worked on the inequality of human beings. And it was the Christian contribution of scholars like Alcuin that led the emerging political organization of the continent to begin to think of people as being equal. The enormous influence of canon law, particularly regarding the place of women in society, cannot be exaggerated. I mean, if you think I'm exaggerating, just look at the work of Larry Sedentor, who is an agnostic Jew, I understand. Who has, in his book, Inventing the Invention of the Individual, given us a very good picture of how Christian influence of people like Alcuin actually changed the situation in law in Western Europe at the time. Well, if he was there on the continent, we had Alfred, King Alfred here. And it wasn't just that he was burning things. Actually, it's quite the other way around, because resisted the Danes and defeated them, but he did not wreak vengeance on them, but incorporated them, tried to incorporate them, into the emerging kingdom, which we have now come to call England. And there were many different elements. There were the Celts, there were the Saxons, there were these Danes. He had to incorporate them all into a new kind of polity. So he took their customs and the laws that they had and tried to bring them together into common law. Common law. That is where the term comes from. But Alfred was insistent that this common law should agree with the Decalogue, with the Ten Commandments. That there should be nothing in this common law that was contrary to biblical revelation. This association of common law in this country, and indeed statutory law, that it should be congruent with divine revelation, has lasted throughout the century. The very liberal judge who reached the top of our profession, you probably now know who I'm talking about, wrote to me, I can't now remember apropos of what, but she said to me, of course, she said, our laws are based on the Ten Commandments and on our Lord's summary of her words. Well, I was very glad to receive the letter. I did wish that her judgments would also reflect this commitment. That's another matter. So there is Alfred, there is Alfred, and then there is St. Anselm. I'll come to St. Anselm for other reasons later on. But in terms of public life, the Synod of Westminster in the year 1102 declared that anyone engaged in the nefarious trade of slavery would be excommunicated. So let no one tell you that it was William Wilberforce or Thomas Clarkson who began the struggle against slavery. It began much earlier. And in fact, the Synod of Westminster actually only reflects the fact that wherever Christianity has spread, slavery has gradually disappeared. We can discuss that later, if you wish. Stephen Langton, another Archbishop of Canterbury, responsible for bringing the barons together and making sure that the tyranny of King John was challenged effectively, the drafting of Magna Carta, and when the fear was that John would renege on what he had agreed with the barons and the bishops, Stephen Langton held Rochester Castle for one whole year to prevent King John from going back on his word. So this contribution to public life is also something that characterizes the English Church. And I am now only speaking about the time before the separation, before the Act of Supremacy. Of course, at the time of the Act of Supremacy, we have the great witness of St. Thomas More and St. John Fisher, Bishop of Rochester, which cannot in any way be underrated, the costliness of that witness. But it is not just the setting up of the parochial system or education, universal education, and it's not just a contribution to public life, but it is also theological contribution. The contribution of the English Church to the theology of the Catholic Church as a whole. Alcuin was a great administrator and educationalist, but he was also a theologian. Anselm, somebody said that he was the most luminous mind between Augustine and Aquinas. That's probably right. His work on the Incarnation, on the Atonement, this is still studied by undergraduates in Cambridge and Oxford. At least I hope it is. still. The ontological argument is still being worked up. The new contribution to it by Anglican Tinder is a case in point. We still haven't reached a decision about the ontological argument. Whenever somebody refutes it, somebody else rehabilitates it, and so on. The contribution of St. John Fisher as a theologian, I think this is very underrated. I think Fisher gets a bad deal. I mean, this is not special theme, by the way, just because he was Bishop of Rochester. But so much attention is given to St. Thomas More, and rightly, of course, I don't begrudge him that. But when it comes to scholarship, I mean, Fisher was a much greater scholar than More. He was a friend of Erasmus, he was a friend of the new learning, but also schooled in the old, in the Via Antiqua, as well as being familiar with the Via Moderna. And his sermons are extremely theologically informed. His writings against Luther and his inspiring of other people, including possibly King Henry, in writing against the early Luther. And then, of course, his writings, which led to his death, in his defense of Queen Catherine. He was our chaplain, of course. This needs to be looked at again. Richard Rex's very fine book on the theology of John Fisher, I do commend it to you. I've got it in my bag. It's probably better for you to buy that than this book that you'll be so later on. It's certainly worth it. And then, of course, theology and philosophy were not separate disciplines in the way that they are now. And if we consider, just for the sake of convenience, the contribution of English churchmen to philosophy, I mean, one could say a great deal, but Duns Scotus, and William of Ockham are really the origin of the tradition of British empiricism. Whether you like it or not, I mean, whether you like the British being empiricist or not, but both Scotus's emphasis on what he called the caritas, the disness of the individual thing, of the individual entity, and Ockham's famous razor, that we should not multiply entities beyond necessity. This became the foundation for British empirical science, which Britain has rightly, England has rightly given to the world. In terms of literature, preface and on ceremony speaks rather disparagingly of the different usages that were current at the time, Hereford, Lincoln, and Sarah. But the fact of the matter is that without Sarah, at least, there would have been no Book of Common Prayer, and therefore no Book of Divine Worship either. So I asked about this when divine worship was being drafted, whether Sarum had been used. And the answer is that some people wanted it used, but it was not used to the extent that it should have been, to my mind anyway. We can debate this. However, because the BCP itself was used, that means that Sarum was indirectly used. I mean, so many of these wonderful comics that we have. Of course, the language we owe to Cranmer, because he was translating. But the thought is of Sarum, and the different usages of Sarum, that I think would enrich the Catholic Church in this country, and not just the ordinary either. The first organ in this country was installed, I think, at Glastonbury in the 8th century. The tradition of monastic and cathedral music. At the popular level, the folk music, and we hear it sometimes during Advent when people sing these medieval carols. And you realize how important that kind of music was for ordinary people who had no access to the monasteries and the cathedrals of this world. And right at the cusp of the separation, we have that amazing partnership between Thomas Tallis and William Byrd. William Byrd was constantly being fined for being a Catholic, and yet remained throughout all this period, for 40 years or so, I think, organist of the Chapel Royal. Nobody seemed to have connected the two at all. Well, I mean, that's some tidiness is good for us. So what I'm saying, brothers and sisters, is that that history of Ecclesia Anglicana, which was always referred to as that, not just in Magna Carta, but in correspondence even with the popes, that history is very important when we come to think about Anglican patrimony and what use is it. That's sort of an impertinent question in a way for me to ask. But when we come to the time of separation, what then? Well, there are several things to be said about it. First of all, that from the earliest period, there were people in the emerging church who were looking to and writing in a way that suggested a direction towards Catholic unity. So if we think of Lancelot Andrews, his Praetus Predictor, I mean, it is quite clear that he believed about the Eucharist, for instance, what the Catholic Church believed. If we think of his devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary, it is quite clear that it was very different from what other Protestants were willing to allow. Jeremy Taylor, who, in spite of his invective against the papacy and so forth, of course, he was a bishop in Ireland, his work on auricular confession, I mean, anyone who says that auricular confession is not important after the Reformation should read Taylor. At least, in terms of providing for us and what they should be. Bishop Thomas Kemp, who, having taken the oath of obedience, oath of allegiance to James II, would not then, like some other bishops and clergy, take another oath to William and Mary, and was so deprived of his see. But it is difficult to imagine anyone in the Roman Catholic Church writing about the Blessed Virgin in a way that can be used. What is that in the New English hymnal? A virgin eyes saw God incarnate born, something like that. And then it goes on. And heaven with transcendent joys, her entrance grace. Next to his throne, her son, his mother place. 200 years before the dogma was defined. That's in the separation. And then, of course, we have the Oxford movement, the work particularly of St. John Henry Newman, and indeed of one who was to become Cardinal Manning in a different sort of way. When Catholics read Newman, I mean, you say that I'm wrong about this, they emphasize what Newman saw as lacking in the Anglican Church that led him to the Catholic Church. And that's not wrong. But I think we have to look at Newman again Because so much of his significant writing was as an Anglican, I mean university sermons for a start, where he was struggling with the whole idea of church. You know, what does it mean to be the church? The question of Erastianism that had been raised. How could the Church of England be freed from these shackles? I mean, all this struggle is very relevant. And, I mean, this is why he wanted to be a bishop in India. Because he felt that in India, at least the Anglican Church might be free of the shackles of the establishment. Well, I can tell you he's wrong about that. That's another story. But then we come to the question of scholarship in the separation. And here I think we have something of abiding value that the Anglican tradition has produced. It can be traced right back to the time before the separation, but it can also be seen in the time of separation in how scholars have worked. And this is a sort of summing up, and it's rather rude and rough. But the Anglican emphasis in theological scholarship has been on the inductive, on the historical, and on the critical. This is quite different from the emphasis in other parts on the deductive, on the speculative and the philosophical. Now, these two approaches do not necessarily contradict one another. I believe they can be shown to be complementary rather than contradictory. But there is a difference in temperament which goes right back to the patristic period. And it is the contrast between Alexandria and Antioch. So Alexandria is philosophical, speculative, deductive, standing, as it were, in the great Hellenistic tradition that Pope Benedict spoke about so and wrote about so often. But Antioch is different, where the emphasis is on the study of the Bible, a historical approach to it, not necessarily an allegorical one, and a critical one that is concerned with what the text is all about, to establish the text and to discern its meaning and the intention of the authors and so on. Now, if you just look at three Anglican biblical scholars of the 19th century, I'm amazed at the work that they did. The work that Westcott did in establishing the Greek edition of the New Testament in the 19th century in the light of the discoveries of new manuscripts. I mean, their entire careers were devoted to this. And then, of course, also F.J. Haught, the third. This is work that we must not only admire, but also be honored. We cannot turn our backs to this kind of careful biblical scholarship. Lightfoot, J.B. Lightfoot, that is to say, and Charles Gore, in the great debate that happened in the 19th century about the nature of the Christian ministry. So Lightfoot, Lightfoot wrote an appendix to his commentary on the letter to the Philippians. And the appendix, I think, is longer than the commentary on the nature of the Christian ministry. To which Gore replied in his book, of course, that I'm sure you are familiar with. Gore was an Anglican bishop, but any Catholic in communion with the See of Rome would profit greatly by reading his book on the origin of the Christian ministry today. this contribution to scholarship continue? I mean, I know that Monsignor Keith is a great admirer of Aidan Mascot. But Aidan Nichols, the great Dominican scholar, called Mascot a teacher of Catholic truth. Mascot, who died in the Anglican fold. Henry Chandler, great patristic scholar. I was doing some lectures at Old Souls College, Oxford, some years ago, and still are. And he was coming, always 10 minutes late, come right up to the front and sit throughout the lecture with his hands, his head in his hands. You didn't know what, you know what he thought about it at all. But the preparatory work that people like Chadwick did for the archaic conversations should not be forgotten, never be forgotten. Pope St. John Paul II called Henry Chadwick a separated doctor of the church. That is absolutely right. J.N.D. Kelly, who taught me his work the Apostles and the Nicene or Constantine Apostolic Creeds, his work on Christian doctrine. This is the kind of scholarship that we must acknowledge as part of the patrimony. In terms of liturgy, whether you agree or disagree with Don Gregory Dix in the shape of the liturgy, or Brightman, what view you take, you cannot deny that they have changed forever the way we think of Christian liturgy. Both died in the Church of England. Where patrimony is concerned, there is a great need to receive. To receive critically, I'm not saying that we should receive these things uncritically, but there is a great richness about it. Now, having said all of that, the question is, what about now and what about the future? The first thing I would say is that if the ordinariate, or the ordinariates, for example, can typify a commitment to scholarship that I think is characteristic of the best in Ecclesia Anglicana, that tradition, that can be a model, an example to the rest of the church. And I say this advisedly, in its thoroughness. And the combination of the critical with the reverent, see, this is very difficult to achieve, because you either get the critical or you get the reverent. But to do both is the challenge that we must face. Community, going back to the earliest period of Theodore setting up the colloquial system, the ordinariate here and indeed elsewhere must model for the rest of the church this commitment, particularly of the priest, but not only of the priest, to the community that is round about. So that the clergy do not think of themselves simply as being mass priests or simply as being pastors to the congregation that chooses to come to, but are committed to the common good, to the welfare of the community in which the church is set. The Church of England is losing, I'm sorry to say, this connection of the clergy with the community, because there are now so many communities that the parish priest has to look after. Nevertheless, it is something that we should not lose. It's of vital importance for the mission of the church, which cannot be written down, and where presence, this commitment of presence, remains very important. Secondly, the question of culture. How to relate to culture. More and more scholars, I mentioned Stephen Talk, Tom Holland is another one, are recognizing that many of the values, even of so-called secular society, have actually been derived from the Christian tradition. And I think they're right about this. Stephen Talk says that the whole notion of a person with conscience is the product of the Christian tradition, of St. Paul's insistence that people should have a personal relationship with Christ. And this is not a Christian saying, by the way. The dignity, inalienable dignity of the human person, we keep coming across this phrase in the Declaration of Independence in the US, the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights, the European Convention, and so on. Where does this come from? So, even the question about equality or liberty. And I think Holland and Sinentor, etc., are right, that these values, although they become secularized, they derive from the Judeo-Christian tradition at its best. Now, several things need to be said about this. First of all, that in the end, you can't have the values without the beliefs. Because, like the Cheshire cat and its smile, they will disappear in due course. The values will disappear if the beliefs are not there. Very well-known Labour government minister, who is now the head of Cambridge College, in a book said that, yeah, of course we have these values from the Christian tradition, but now that we have them, we don't need the tradition. And the example that was given was of a ladder, that you need the ladder to climb up, and then you don't need it when you're up there. Well, in my experience, you often do need it because you want to come down again. So it's very foolish to get rid of it. So that's one thing, that you can't have the values without the beliefs indefinitely. The second is that the values, and Holland and Sinentor don't pay enough attention to this, in my opinion. The second is that the values themselves have mutated. They've changed. So the dignity of the human person is based on the Christian, Judeo-Christian idea that we made in God's image, of course. But they have mutated, this value has mutated into the secular view of what you might call mere autonomy. You see, the Christian idea of the human person is that of relationship with God, with family, with other people. Autonomy is monadism. It's isolation. And this was revealed to me very dramatically in that BBC film. I wrote about it the next day in the Times, where the man goes to Dignitas for euthanasia, assisted dying, as they call it. His wife, who is totally opposed to, nevertheless decides to go with him. I don't know if people saw that film, whether you remember it. And she goes with him, and when he's being given the lethal injection by the nurse, he cries out for water. And the wife reaches instinctively for a glass to give it to him. And the nurse holds her arm do this, it will delay the death. But what does that say? That in this matter of assisted dying, we are not on our own. Whether we like it or not, there are spouses to consider, there are children to consider, their relatives, their friends, and most of all, their vulnerable people who may be affected by our decision. And for sin. Equality. The Bible's teaching on equality is based on the fact that we have common origins. We have a common origin in a common parent, Adam and Eve. But the teaching of the Bible and of the Christian tradition is about the equality of persons. And this has come true, as I was saying, in the development of law in the first century. But this is mutated into the equality of every kind of lifestyle or behavior. Now this will never end. I mean, there's no end to people claiming equality for this or that lifestyle or behavior. Liberty, freedom of the human person is rooted in the view that people have an internal form, they have a conscience, which takes precedence over any other demand on them. That because they have conscience, they must consent even to how they are governed. And it is this view of the human person in Aquinas, actually, that changed the subject into a citizen. Pope Benedict, seeing as we're talking about him, one journalist said to him, he said, "Well, for hundreds of years, the Roman Catholic Church has been saying error has no rights. Now you are talking about religious freedom. How is this?" And he said in reply, he said, "In this we have gone back to the earliest form of tradition." And so the journalist said, "Oh, what's that?" And he said, it's the teaching of Jesus himself. Well, that's a pretty good answer. But again, it does remind us that a proper view of Christian freedom includes responsibility. It cannot be merely libertarian. I was for many years the chair of a public body, and I had some very prominent libertarians on the committee. And I assure you, brothers and sisters, that nothing is sacred for the libertarians. Nothing. Everything can be sacrificed at the altar of utilitarianism if they can demonstrate the need. So, our response to culture has been, yes, has to be, to recognize what the origins are, but also to point out the mutation, the harmful mutations that have taken place. And to urge people to return to a view that belief and value are intrinsically and intimately related and cannot be separate. Just to give you one example from my own experience, Tony Blair's government had introduced this business about pre-legislative scrutiny of certain kinds of legislation. And this was a bill that was coming to Parliament. It was first called the Mental Incapacity Bill. And somebody pointed out that this was not a very felicitous title. So they changed the title of the bill to the Mental Capacity Bill. The same bill. But anyway, we were doing pre-legislative scrutiny, and the lady, again you probably now know who it is, who is responsible for most liberal legislation in this country in the last 50 years, she became very active and disturbed. So the chairman said, "What's the matter?" And she said, "Well, the question was, Can a person who has lost the capacity to respond to signals still retain the protection due to a human being? And he said, well, but that protection can never be taken away. So I said to her, well, it's very good to hear you say that, but on what do you base what you're saying? And she said, well, she said, it's a Judeo-Christian idea, isn't it, that we're made in God's image? I said, hallelujah, of course it is. So glad that you were saying that and not me. I mean, what I'm saying is that in the end, there are certain things like the dignity of the human person, the equality of all human beings in spite of appearances, that need a transcendental explanation. And you can't just hold the value without any kind of understanding of how these values have actually arisen. So there is the community, there is culture, and then there is the cult. So Anglican patrimony has a great deal to offer the church in terms of the richness of worship, of music, of language, of resources, that cannot be and should not be consigned to some kind of antiquarian interest. I think that's the point. It has to do with liturgical scholarship. It has to do with an awareness of what the English Church has contributed to the wider church in the past and what it can do now. Once again, the ordinariates have been called to be a witness to this, and I'm sure that they are being. But I want to finish with this. This is ongoing work. The ordinariate, through the generosity of Pope Benedict, is a very important beginning in how the Catholic Church views diversity. I mean, the Catholic Church is a very diverse church. You know, there are 23, I think, Eastern Rite churches, for a start, that all have their own canon law, their own liturgical tradition, and so forth. The West also has had diversity. I've been very interested in how the most Arab, that's the word, the most Arab, anglicized to most Arab, the most Arabic communities of the Iberian Peninsula, this is in the West, not the East, contributed to the transmission of learning to many of Europe. Well, the most Arabic liturgy is still a liturgy that is used. The Ambrosian Rite, the Dominican use, I was at Black Friars at the weekend. Now, of course, the ordinary use. The whole process of a proper inculturation of worship will be hindered if we have a false idea that the West has some kind of liturgical and canonical unity which may not be necessary in the end. It is quite possible to have, I mean, the Eastern Church has shown that it's quite possible to have diversity many different kinds, whilst all of that still being in conformity with Catholic truth and teaching. There's no necessary reason why that shouldn't be the case. And of course, there must be organs that determine whether something is or is not in conformity with Catholic truth. And in this, we've been surprised in our ecumenical era. So the Catholic Church now views both the non-Chalcedonian churches and their Christology as Orthodox, and of their opponents, the Assyrian Church of the East and so-called Nestorians, also as Orthodox, even to the point where the Catholic Church has now decided that the liturgy valid Eucharist. So what you have got is considerable flexibility in how Catholic truth is understood and explained and how it makes for the unity of the wider church. So I thank you very much for your patience in listening to these rambling thoughts, and I look forward to your response. Thank you very much.
Studying liturgy, he was doing his license in liturgy, and his particular subject, he wasn't a member of the ordinaries in the States, but his particular subject was the funeral offices of the ordinaries, which is a niche market, I thought. But I said to him, I said, tell me, what would you regard as your, you know, the sort of main text, the best text on liturgy? And he said, Dom Gregory Dix. So, this is an opportunity for any questions if anybody would like to ask Monsignor. And ask any questions about this lecture or comments or sort of directions.
Thank you. Thank you, Monsignor, for a great lecture.
You need to speak up because there's no microphone.
Okay, so can you all hear me? Thank you so much for the lecture. I think there's one point that I'm not coming to inquire about, if you don't mind. That's about the Antiochian and the Alexandrian traditions. To my understanding, that St. John Henry Newman, when he writes his book on the Arian controversy, he has a problem with the Antiochian approach, and he prefers the Alexandrian. And it's Adolf von Hahn that puts a kind of clear Antioch versus Alexandria, and then scholars are saying that it's the modern kind of historical critical approach being read back into the Antiochian that doesn't actually exist in that form, but somehow they like to bring it back like that. However, more recently, scholars who are alive, like Francis Young or Louis Ayres or John Mayer, they have called into question that whole idea of Antioch and Alexandria. And they're saying that Antioch really consists of three people when we talk about this particular approach, being Theodore of Mamsousius being one of them, and Theodore of Tarsus, who were teachers of Nestorius. And that the Alexandrians actually, they've never been unhistorical, but they have a different approach to history, where these three people, and if you follow their sort of approach, you end up in Nestorianism because they are subjecting Christ to history rather than seeing history in the light of Christ. So, sorry, these are so many thoughts. So
where's the question?
Well, I suppose it's more of a comment about, first, that in Anglicanism, St. John Henry Newman took a different approach than the Orthodox movement took, you know, like they went all kind of for, you know, sort of Antiochian and Alexandrian. Definitely, St. John Henry Newman, as far as I understand, that he was more on the Alexandrian side. But however, in more modern times, the whole premise has been called into question. And so I wonder to what extent we should therefore hold on to Antiochian in that sort of sense over against Alexandrian. Thank you.
Thank you, yes. These things are not in sealed containers, of course, but take the question of the handling of scripture. I mean, it's not just Theodore of Suestia, even St. John Chrysostom, his entire key and his approach, and you can see that in his work. So each side has its dangers. So I think the entire key side has the danger reducing everything to history. But the Alexandrian side has the danger of handling scripture in such a way that the original meaning is completely lost. So the allegorical interpretation that goes, you know, becomes more and more outlandish. There is also, I think, the relationship to Hellenism. I mean, we're talking about Pope Benedict, and he spoke of the providential nature in which purified Hellenism has assisted the Church in articulating its theology. And to a very great extent, this is correct. And he said this is the reason why so many Christian developments have taken place in Europe, except, he said, for some important developments in the East. Well, one of the important developments in the East is, of course, monasticism. And in this, if you compare, I mean, even if you remain in Egypt, if you compare Athanasius with Anthony, the father of monasticism, so Athanasius is completely Hellenized and belongs in that sense to the Alexandrian way of thinking and writing. Anthony did not know Greek. He was probably illiterate. And yet the two men had tremendous respect for one another. I think the East Syrian tradition, with which of course you are very familiar, has a different approach. I mean, I don't think the best of it is captivity in history, but it is a historical, non-speculative approach which could result in reductionism. I don't deny that. But I think Alexandria could result in exaggeration. In the Middle Ages, we see this, for example, in the way praise Duns Scotus. This idea that if anything is possible, it must be true. So if it's possible to give the Blessed Virgin Mary some titles, then we must do so, regardless of the evidence in Revelation or in the Fathers or in the creeds. So I think with those twin dangers we must avoid, but at the same time, what I'm trying to say is that there is actually no reason why two sorts of temperaments cannot be held together, and indeed must be held together.
First of all, Father, thank you for inducting me to my freehold, two parishes in Kent, through which the Medway flows. I still hold it, even though it's never here anymore. I just want to ask you, since the Church of England and the Anglican Communion very fertile ground for scholarship, biblical scholarship, theology, and so forth for centuries. Are there still parts of the Anglican, as the Church of England declines so visibly, are there still parts of the Anglican Church where you think that scholarship will continue to flourish and feed the rest of the Christian body?
I think the answer, in all sobriety, has to be no. I mean, there are, you know, there are Anglican scholars in Africa and Asia now, but their scholarship isn't ecclesial in the sense that I've been talking about. And I don't know whether it will become such under pressure. I don't see any signs of it. I think that in the end, communion with the See of Rome is what might release Anglicans for scholarship. It's a strange thing to say, but I mean, that is the case now, whatever may have been the case in the past.
Thank you, sir. Well, Monsignor, thank you very much for your presentation. I was very interested in your topic on community, because I see that as a matter of opportunity, but also an immense challenge. I think any of us who are converts from Anglicanism have discovered that once in the Catholic world, after a typical Mass in a typical Catholic church, everyone just leaves.
tea or coffee.
Well, you're saying clearly what I did.
Right. I'm just wondering, that is one of the strengths of what we experience as people when we were Anglicans. It seems to be, just on a practical level, a significant challenge to try to perhaps build up that kind of culture of community within a church, within a parish, much more beyond the congregation, if you will. So in that respect, are there practical ways, do you see, for us who are former Anglicans, especially the people that are doing Anglican structured Anglican ethos, of being able to successfully infuse the Catholic culture here in England with that sense of community amongst worshippers and fellowship?
Yes. Well, I think there are two words here. One is hospitality, and the other is amnesty. So maybe the two depend on one. But by hospitality, I mean intentionally making sure that people come together and eat together and drink together and that kind of thing. Now, that may not be immediately after mass, not necessary, but it should be the case that there are events where this happens in a meaningful way. That is also the question about welcoming. I was horrified the other day when a young lady came into church. She said this was the first time she'd come into church. And the parish priest, I was a celebrant, the parish priest was around, and he immediately started asking her where she lived and why she should not go to the Catholic church near her. I mean, she was completely unaware of it. And I thought, well, she'd never come again. This is the thing, it just puts people off. So, setting the embassy, which is going out into the community, that may be in terms of visiting people for preparation for various things, or it could be the Legion of Mary. Some of the Legion of Mary was being established somewhere, and the people were expressing their concern about, they said, oh, they go out and preach in the open air and so on. Doesn't bother me. So I said, why don't you get them to visit homes in the community? There was horror at this. He said, but they're not Catholics. I said, it doesn't matter if they're not Catholic. Prayer visiting, for instance. You just knock on the door and someone comes and says, oh, you know, we're from the Catholic Church. What can we pray for you? And I guarantee that 99% of people will not reject it. That's all. But it's a way of reaching into the community. And Morrissey, in her book, The Good Samaritan, talks about adding value to church activity. So you just add gospel value to something you're doing already in the community or in the church. I mean, there are so many ways that you can do this.
By which I mean,
unless you wanted to respond to that.
No, because you've been very patient.
But thank you very much, Monsignor, for your talk. My interest follows on from what you were saying, because there's a difference, isn't there, between engaging in the argument and trying to suppress it. That was a wonderful quotation. Error has no rights. It's a history of suppression. And I think of my dear wife, who's Russian Orthodox. She went to Sunday school in Russia, and she was thrown out because she was called a heretic. I don't think she was heretical. I think she was asking a lot of questions, and she also wanted to know about Jesus' brothers and sisters. That was the end. She was thrown out. Then she went to a convent, which was quite young, about sort of 15 and a half. Try a hand at that. And the nuns asked her what she wanted to do, and she said, I want to read the Gnostic Gospels. She was sent to work in the kitchen. Well, this is life as we know it, I suppose. But the Anglican tradition, as epitomized by this fellow, Armitage Robinson, who was dean of various establishments, lastly, I think Westminster Abbey, wasn't it? And he said just this simple line, really: it is a fundamental principle that criticism must be met by criticism, not by counter-assertion. Would you agree, Martin?
Totally. And I mean, I think the Catholic Church now certainly finds room for that kind of scholarship, and I mean, that's a good thing. Monsignor King has been very reserved in answer to Joanna's points. I mean, there's no reason why the Catholic Church as a whole, including the ordinary, should not develop ways for women to be active in the church in a number of ways. It's not just religious communities, but I know that, for instance, I don't think it's actually happened, but it could happen. What happens if ordained Anglican women want to become Catholics? What happens to them? Are they just, is what they have done completely ignored? Or is it possible to have an order, a pastoral workers order, or teachers order, or whatever to which they might belong? I mean, these matters have been considered as. So it's not, these are not closed issues. I mean, on the high church business, the fact is that when the ordinariate was set up, those who were under Catholics, like Monsignor Keith, were in the forefront, and so worship was organized in that way. But there is no reason why the divine worship should not be used in other ways. He will tell you, I thought he would tell you, that in your Council of Priests, out of the 15, 6 are people who were trained at Ridley and Wigley.
There were more Wycliffe and Ridley, which is the Evangelical College, than were St. Stephen House of Murphy.
Well, Father Timothy, I think I first called
him. Yes, he was Wycliffe.
Yeah.
Okay, so surrender. Just one more question.
Thank you.
Yes, well, I mean, those, you know, the people are thinking and working in that area, as you know. The problem about people being at home in the church, and of course many of these people were, but two Anglican scholars, Philip Turner and Ephraim Radner, have written a very important book called The Faith of Communion, in which they say that what has happened in the Church of England and in some parts of the Anglican Communion is actually can be traced back to an original flaw. They locate that flaw in Erastianism. This is, of course, what cost Moore and Fisher their lives. When Henry demanded of the congregations that they should accept him as supreme head of the Church of England, Fisher recommended to the congregation, I mean, this was under pain, fine, deprivation, Fisher recommended to the congregations that they should say they accepted the royal supremacy insofar as the law of Christ allowed. I mean, those words are very important. Insofar as the law of Christ allowed. Now, what has happened according to Turner and Radner is that the Erastian tendency has come out on top over and against the apostolic claims of the church, which many of the people you mentioned were wanting to hold on to. And so what has happened is a capitulation to culture. Capitulation, not engagement, but capitulation to culture, which was always inherent in what Henry had demanded.
I think we must draw to a close. Thank you very much for coming this evening, Inspector. Thank you, Monsignor, for the very erudite and enjoyable lecture. And I hope this is the first of many that we will have. Please, if you've got time, join us for a glass of wine downstairs. And I think we'll stand for the blessing. The Lord be with you. Lady and all the saints pray for you, St. Michael and all the angels guard and protect you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
These books, if anybody wants to buy one, are how much are they?
I think they're
£18.99.
I think we've got £20.
£13. Oh yes, a bargain. £13.